वेलकम बैक फ्रेंड्स. वी हैव आवर फोन टोल फ्री नंबर दैट इज़ 1800112345. सो इफ़ एनी ऑफ द कैंडिडेट हैव एनी क्वेरी, वी हैव आवर एक्सपर्ट पैनल अवेलेबल. दे विल ट्राई टू सॉल्व द क्वेरीज. नाउ मूविंग ऑन टू नेक्स्ट सेशन, वी विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट पैथोफिजियोलॉजी ऑफ GERD, दैट इज़ गैस्ट्रो इसोफिजियल रिफ्लक्स डिजीजेज. वी हैव विद अस डॉक्टर राजेश गोदारा, who is associate professor from the department of surgery at PGIMS Rohtak. He is here to discuss and deliberate on pathophysiology of GERD. So may I request Dr. Rajesh to deliberate upon the very important topic, that is GERD pathophysiology. Sir.
Thank you. Good evening, dear friends. Let us start with the topic gastroesophageal reflux disease, and we shall concentrate only on the pathophysiology rather than on the diagnostic workup of a GERD or any treatment plans of GERD and not the surgical part, only the pathophysiology. Now GERD, that is gastroesophageal reflux disease, is a such a common disease that in every surgical or medicine OPD we came across so many patients either with the problems due to reflux or the complications of the reflux. So before understanding the pathophysiology, let us brief have a look into the anatomy and the relevant physiology involved in the gastroesophageal reflux disease. So if we see the anatomically, esophagus is divided into three parts, that is cervical, thoracic and abdominal. The functionally esophagus is divided into upper esophageal sphincter, the esophageal body and lower esophageal sphincter. So this is the slide showing the esophagus starting at the cricopharyngeal junction at the level of C6 vertebra and then piercing the diaphragm in the esophageal hiatus at the level of T11, slightly to the left of the midline, about 25 to 30 centimeter long, lies anterior to vertebral column, the longus coli muscles. Then it has cervical, thoracic and abdominal segments are there. Its relation is shown in the slides with the anterior lying trachea. On the side there is aorta which successively pass behind it at it enters the hiatus, and then it pierces the esophageal diaphragmatic hiatus. Now if the relevant anatomy of esophageal hiatus, that is the most important part in a gastroesophageal reflux disease, if we see the esophageal hiatus from the abdominal side, then it is an inverted tear shaped opening. It is bounded anteriorly and laterally by the diaphragmatic crura, and posteriorly there is median arcuate ligament, that is thickened fascia between the two longitudinal limbs of the right and left crest of the diaphragm. Then there is phrenoesophageal ligament. It also provides support to esophagus, keeping it inside the abdominal cavity. That is necessary for preventing the reflux. We will discuss in the next slides. And this is phrenoesophageal ligament has two parts, that is endoabdominal and endothoracic fascia. This is the slide showing the tear-shaped opening. And this is the esophagus through the esophageal hiatus, and this is the right crest of the diaphragm. This is the longitudinal limb, and this right crest then crosses, and on the other side it also forming its left as well as right boundaries. And on the left side there is, this is the left crest of the diaphragm, and posteriorly this is the arcuate ligament which separates this esophageal hiatus from the aorta. And this is the phrenoesophageal ligament. The two parts of the phrenoesophageal ligament, that is endothoracic part and the endoabdominal part. This is nothing but the facial condensation of the fascia transversalis, and it is inserted on the lower musculature of the lower part musculature of the esophagus as well as in the upper part of the stomach. And this membrane is supposed to help in keeping the esophagus, a part of the esophagus, the distal esophageal inside the abdominal cavity, and with the age this gets degenerated and may be responsible for high prevalence of hiatus hernia in old age patients. And this is the slide showing the frenoesophageal membrane lining on either side of the edgeway on the esophagus. And this is the esophagus, this is the left cusp, then is the right is there, and this is the frenoesophageal membrane. And this is the laparoscopic view of the esophageal hiatus. If we see with the laparoscope, then there is, this is the right cusp, and this is the left lobe of the liver. Then there is the caudate lobe, and here this is a frenoesophageal membrane which has been dissected. And this is the esophagus, and this is the left cusp of the diaphragm. Now coming to esophagogastric junction, the most important part in preventing the reflux. The definition of esophagogastric junction is, there are multiple definitions, but the most practical and clinically relevant definition is, it is the junction of esophageal squamous epithelium with the gastric columnar epithelium. Anatomically, the definition is point at which the tubular esophagus joins the gastric pouch, doesn't have any clinical relevance. And physiological classification of the junction, like the junction of esophageal circular muscle layer with the oblique sling fiber of the stomach. Now coming to the detailed anatomy of this esophageal junction, lower esophageal sphincter, the distal 2-3 cm of the esophagus is intra-abdominal. And the important part is, this is not an anatomical sphincter, means there is grossly on gross examination, there is nothing like sphincter. But if we see the physiological aspect, this is a zone of high pressure zone, manometrically high pressure zone is there, having a pressure more than 20 mmHg. And of course, this pressure changes with the change of body position, as well as during the different phases of inspiration, as well as different activities of the body. This GE junction is a fairly fixed structure, and is fixed to extraperitoneal esophageal fixation is there, then gastropancreatic ligament is there, and left gastric vessels, these all provide some form of fixation. In normal condition, this is a tonically closed part of the esophagus. Now the intrinsic muscles of the lower esophageal sphincter, two types of muscle are there. One is the circular muscle, that is the clasp. These are the continuation of the circular muscle of the esophagus, and there are the gastric sling fibers. These are the longitudinal muscle of the esophagus continuing on the fundus of the stomach. And these gastric sling fibers are, they are much more developed on the left lateral aspect, leading to asymmetry during manometric examination. These both muscles have different and unique contractile properties. And the acetylcholine is the excitatory mediator leading to tonicity of the lower esophageal sphincter, while the nitrous oxide is inhibitory mediator involved in the lower esophageal sphincter relaxation. This is the diagram showing the circular muscles on this side, the left side, and here is the clasp fibers, the oblique fibers over the fundus of the stomach. And these clasp fibers are responsible for making this esophagogastric junction angle, that is the angle of its, and also responsible for oblique entry of the esophagus into the stomach, to some extent preventing the reflux of any gastric content into the esophagus. Now the next part of this lower esophageal sphincter is the diaphragm. This diaphragm is the external sphincter, while the smooth muscles of the lower esophagus, they constitute the internal sphincter. And in the diaphragm, this is the mainly the right cusp which helps in providing a differential pressure. And the lower esophageal sphincter pressure can change from 10 to 100 millimeter of mercury with different phases of respiration. During inspiration, when there is increased intra-abdominal pressure, the diaphragm contracts and this contraction of the crura of the diaphragm increases the lower esophageal sphincter pressure. Otherwise, due to increase in intra-abdominal pressure, there is tendency to push the intra-abdominal intragastric contents into the esophagus. But because of this tight sphincter, that is the external sphincter, this is prevented. Then these diaphragmatic crural fibers, they relaxes during the act of swallow to allow the food bolus to go into the stomach. Then during telesers, the transient lower esophageal sphincter relaxations, these are the normal relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter during the act of swallow. As the food bolus enters the fundus of the stomach, the vagus is innervated, and this vagus then from the basal brainstem nuclei send the efferent fibers which relaxes the sphincter. And these the benefit of these transient esophageal relaxation is there. These allows the extra air in the stomach which we have ingested with food to vent it out, so that there is no upper GI discomfort in the immediate post-operative period, like bloating sensation or heaviness in the upper abdomen. And this crural fiber also relaxes during the act of vomiting and expiration. In hiatus hernia, as there is distortion in the role of a diaphragmatic hiatus, so there is increased chances of reflexes. Now coming to the role of phrenoesophageal ligament. As we have already discussed, it attaches the GE junction to the diaphragm, and its role in GERD is controversial. Its role is not well proved that it has any significant role in preventing the reflexes. The upper attachment of the esophagus is on the muscular ring and lower attachment on the mucosal ring of the GE junction. There's two layers. The thinner one is the endothoracic fascia and thick one is the endoabdominal fascia. This phrenoesophageal ligament is consists of collagen, elastin and smooth muscle, and there occurs age related degeneration in the phrenoesophageal ligament. And I have already told that this degenerative changes may be having some effect on a high incidence of hiatal hernia in old age patients. And the elastic property of this ligament, as well as its firm attachment on either side to the diaphragm, prevents the displacement of esophagus into the thoracic cavity. This is the position, the slide showing the position of phrenoesophageal ligament. There is the phrenoesophageal ligament in normal condition. It is inserted and keeps the esophagogastric junction down in the abdominal cavity. But in case of hiatus hernia like this, this is stretched upward. And due to this stretching and weakness of this phrenoesophageal ligament, it no longer allows this lower esophagus to remain inside the abdominal cavity. Now coming to the brief relevant physiology of the esophagus. Esophagus is divided into upper esophageal sphincter, then esophageal, lower esophageal sphincter, and one more is the high pressure zone. If we see the lower esophageal sphincter, that is more relevant in the gastroesophageal reflux disease. It is the functional sphincter, as I have already discussed. This is not an anatomical sphincter. The lower end of the esophagus, about 3 to 5 centimeter zone, is increased pressure zone at the lower end. And this lower esophageal sphincter, it relaxes with swallowing, so that it allows the food bolus to enter the stomach. After that, it contracts just after the food bolus has reached the stomach. And this prevents a reflex. Otherwise, when the contraction of stomach is there, and already there are food residues in the stomach, they can reflex back into the esophagus. To prevent this reflex, immediately after the act of swallowing is complete, it contracts. This tone of the sphincter is provided by intrinsic myogenic activity, the smooth muscle of the lower esophagus sphincter. And a relaxation is by neural mediated, that is by vagus nerve. Now the high pressure zone. Classically, it is believed to be equivalent to lower esophageal sphincter, means whatever there is the lower esophageal sphincter, that is high pressure zone. But it is not like this. Now it is felt that the high pressure is not only determined by the lower esophageal sphincter smooth muscle, but also the peri-esophageal environment is also responsible for this high pressure. This peri-esophageal environment, like intra-abdominal positive pressure, which have a compression effect on the lower esophagus, and it gives some extra pressure. Now the physiology of swallowing. The three different types of peristaltic activity occurring in the esophagus are primary peristalsis, which are progressive and triggered by voluntary swallowing, and they help in passage of the food bolus down. Then is the secondary peristalsis. These are also progressive, means they help in progression of the contents, and they are generated by distension of the lower esophagus. When the food bolus reaches in the lower part of the esophagus, this secondary peristalsis starts. Also, they are started if there is low pH in the lower esophagus, like during the normal reflex. I have already discussed the telesers. When there is normal reflex of gastric contents into the esophagus, because due to this secondary peristalsis, whatever the reflexite is there, that is passed down. Then there are tertiary peristalsis, and these peristalsis are not of any clinical use. They are non-progressive, mean they do not help in progression of the food material. They are uncoordinated, and these tertiary peristalsis, they are responsible for the corkscrew appearance in the barium study of the esophagus. Then coming to physiology of a lower esophageal sphincter, the resting intrathoracic pressure is about -5 to -10 cm of water, and the intra-abdominal pressure is 0 to 10 cm of water. Means always there is a tendency for the intra-abdominal parts or the contents inside the intestinal stomach to be reflexed back into the thoracic cavity due to this pressure gradient. And this pressure gradient, it becomes very high during in a supine position, and also during the act of forced inspiration, the pressure rises up to 100 cm of water. This gradient may be so high. Because of this high gradient, there is tendency for the reflexite to go into esophagus, but this is prevented by the pinch-cock diaphragmatic contraction of the crest of the diaphragm, and it prevents the gastroesophageal reflex. Now the normal physiological reflex. This normal physiological reflex, or telesers, these are more common in awake and upright position. They are less in sleep and supine position. And these reflexes occur during the transient relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter. And lower esophageal pressure is slightly high in the supine position. So in supine position, reflexes occur less as compared to in the upright position. Now in the pathophysiology of GERD, these telesers are the most common culprits, and these are mediated by the vagovagal reflex as a result of gastric distension after the intake of food bolus. This gastric distension irritates the vagal efferent fibers. These efferent fibers then send impulses to the brainstem nuclei, and from it the vagal efferent fibers, they transmit the signal to the lower esophageal sphincter and causes relaxation. Now, what are the various factors which prevent the reflex? The various factors which prevent reflex are: one is the acute angle of entry of the esophagus in the stomach, so that it is not in direct continuity. Then there is pinch-cock effect of the right crest of the diaphragm, and this diaphragm, as we have already discussed, this helps to prevent the reflex mainly during the act of inspiration, deep inspiration. Then there is frenoesophageal ligament, which helps in keeping the lower esophagus in the intra-abdominal high pressure zone. Then there is mucosal rosette at the lower end of the esophagus, which also have some role in preventing the reflex, of course very minor one. And then important part is the persistent activity of the smooth muscle in the lower third of the esophageal that constitute the lower esophageal sphincter, the most important component to prevent the reflux. Then the thickened circular muscle also have some role, and the sling fiber of the stomach, which maintain the angle of ease, also have, of course, minimal but role in preventing the reflux of gastric contents into the esophagus. Now coming to the basic, what is GERD? The GERD is a complex disorder, and there is no universally accepted classification or definition for GERD. Three types of definition have been proposed. One is the definition by symptoms, and this I think is the simplest one, but again it is neither sensitive nor specific because there are so many inherent problems with it, like the symptoms of GERD, which are like regurgitation of the food, then heartburn is there, dysphagia may be there. All these can occur in condition other than esophageal pathology, like cardiac problem, pulmonary lesions, or some extra intestinal diseases also can have same type of symptoms. So this is not a classification of any clinical relevance. Then is the endoscopic definition, means depending upon the finding on endoscopy, we can define the whether there is any reflux disease or not. In 90% of the cases, this holds true, and there are changes in the esophagus making the diagnosis of gastroesophageal reflux disease. But in rest of the cases,
because of chemicals,
like is taking some drugs, then endoscopy cannot differentiate whether these changes are because of the chemicals or these are due to the reflexate of the acid into the esophagus. Then one important entity is NERD, that is non-erosive reflux disease, in which the symptoms are truly of GERD, but endoscopically there is no finding. So in these subset of patient, this endoscopic definition doesn't hold true. Of course, this is the most commonly used definition for GERD. The next definition is pathophysiologic definition of GERD.